Welcome to the Dare to Know podcast. I'm your host, Fabian Korver. Today we are joined by Jean Brickmont. Jean Brickmont is a Belgian theoretical physicist and philosopher of science. He is emeritus professor at the Catholic University of Leuven. His recent books include Quantum Sense and Nonsense, Making Sense of Quantum Mechanics, and he also co-edited the book Chomsky Notebook. You can find the links to these books in the description below. I hope you enjoyed this episode. The Dare to Know podcast is now also available on iTunes and Spotify. Please check out the links in the description below. Professor Brickmont, welcome to the Dare to Know podcast.
Thank you very much for having me.
Yes, thank you so much for being here. So before starting, could you maybe tell my audience a little bit more about your background? And then also maybe how did you get interested in the work of Noam Chomsky?
Yes, unlike I think most of the people you have been interviewing so far, I looked at several of them. I'm not a philosopher, I'm not in cognitive science, I'm a physicist. And I'm a retired physicist, but I was a physicist. And I got my PhD in 1977. And at that time, I'd never heard of Chomsky. I'd vaguely seen a book published by communists, which was refuting, in a silly way, but refuting his linguistics. And I never heard of him, even though I'd read a lot about a lot of people, but anyway. And so I went to the States as a postdoc in 1978, and there it was kind of a shock because you see, Europe at that time was divided between conservative and let's say a left, which was broadly speaking social democrat or communist in France and Italy, but social democrat. And it was, you know, the old left in a sense, okay? It was more emphasizing socialism, the role of the working class, et cetera, et cetera. And when I went to the United States, I discovered American liberalism. And American liberalism then came, I don't know, in the Netherlands, but it came in France through Libération, Le Monde, et cetera, later. It came during the Mitterrand years. It wasn't that popular at that time. And American liberalism is a very sneaky ideology, which I don't like, but it's sort of, it looks attractive. It, let's everybody be free and do what you want, etc., and free speech and so on, which was not the position of the conservative in Europe at that time, or Catholics, or these in Belgium, or maybe Protestants elsewhere. And the anti-communism was linked to religion and so on and so forth, and also sometimes was nostalgic for fascism and so on. All this was not part of the liberal ideology. And since I came from sort of a mixture, if you wish, which was the post-68 left, but the post-68 left was mixed between the leftover from the old left and then what became later the new left, which was basically importing American liberalism in Europe and which we are still with, which is, of course, you know, we'll get to that later. But anyway, I had a politics, my politics were superficial, were radical in words, but they were superficial and somewhat frivolous because this new left, or at least the part like Foucault is the best example. I wasn't Foucault, but there was also Althusser, was there. I mean, all these French intellectuals were part of the, you know, people talk being the left, but their criticism of the society was, I think, rather superficial. And when I went to the United States, the strength of American liberalism, I mean, it's not something I had any answer to because, you know, the new left was speaking about Marx, but also about Freud and so on. And it was pretty unscientific. And that was something that the liberals could easily dismiss. So by accident, really by accident, in a public library, I started to read Chomsky. I read the, you know, For Reasons of State and The Backroom Boys and At War with Asia and so on and so forth. And I was really captivated by him because his criticism of American imperialism was serious and his criticism of capitalism was serious. It wasn't frivolous in the way that French theoreticians might have been or people would, I would call pre-postmodernists because it wasn't really postmodernism back then, but it led to postmodernism afterwards. Mm-hmm. And the other thing, of course, that was even more shocking for me was the issue of human nature, because then I started to read his popular book on linguistics and human minds and human nature, etc. And this, we'll go back to that in the discussion, was something that looked to me utterly reactionary. That was the view that people had of any talk about human nature. So implicitly, but not explicitly, but implicitly, the denial of human nature was present everywhere in my culture, in the culture of the left at that time. Speaking of human nature put you on the far right. And ever since, then I came back to Europe. Well, I went back and forth between Europe and the US till the 1990s, but I came back in the early 80s, 1980s. And there I tried to speak to people about Chomsky, but that was impossible. And I still have had zero success 40 years later, basically, in trying to, I've had some success with some people, but not many. And of course, one thing I guess we should go back to that later, got me into a lot of trouble is the issue of free speech linked to the Faurisson affair, which you may certainly know. I'll explain it later, maybe in the talk. But that made the discussion of Chomsky totally impossible. Because you see, on the one hand, he defended nativism or innateness, which was reactionary, okay?
Yep.
And then on the other hand, he was fascist because he was defending free speech for Faurisson. So everything was there in this absolutely confused mentality that existed at the time to make him into somebody on the far right, and everybody who defend him is on the far right. I myself, I'm still, for the business of free speech, I'm still considered on the far right, to the point that anti-fascists have been able to cancel even a physics seminar by me. And of course, they cancel everything else. So the cancel culture I'm used to. And that's the situation. It doesn't change all that much. I mean, with globalization and with 9/11, the political Chomsky has been more audible, let's say. Because 9/11 and the wars in Afghanistan, Iraq, and so on, has made him more audible. Le Monde Diplomatique has made a lot to make him, I wrote even about that in Le Monde Diplomatique, to make him more acceptable or more audible in some circles, at least, not everywhere. But as far as the human nature story and so on, that I'm not sure, the philosophy, as you call it, I don't think it has moved very much.
Okay.
That's how we got interested in that, for both for political reason and philosophical reason. And both were quite, mostly the philosophy was quite a shock because I didn't expect that at all.
Mm-hmm. No, that's very interesting. And I think, we'll unpack a lot of this in this conversation. So kind of the aim of this conversation is indeed to kind of understand Chomsky, but also his influence in France. So we're kind of...
Lack thereof, yes.
So we'll start by discussing an article you wrote in the book Chomsky Notebook titled Chomsky, France, Reason, Power. And then kind of after understanding this context of Chomsky and his influence or not his influence in France, we can dive deeper into the famous debate between Chomsky and Foucault. So you start off by saying in your article, our purpose is not to justify or to certify Chomsky's ideas, but to supply a backdrop against which to read them, emphasizing what it is that makes them original and what it is that makes them hard to accept in France. So, yeah, you already alluded to it a few times. Why are Chomsky's views so hard to accept in France or French intellectual culture?
Yeah, okay. Now I'm going to go into somewhat of some speculation. You see, there is a historian of physics named Forman, nothing to do with the filmmaker, who wrote an article about the cultural climate in which quantum mechanics was developed in the 20s in Germany, in the German-speaking Europe mostly, and who emphasized, well, whether he's right or wrong about that, about the indeterminism and so on. Although I could give a podcast on quantum again, I won't go into that today, but let's say what he's saying, what is interesting is that describing the cultural atmosphere of Germany after the war. And that cultural atmosphere is, dominated by irrationalism, and he sees the way the physicists have reacted to this irrationalist climate. You must remember that in July 1918, because the Netherlands were not involved in that war, but the Germans were still on the offensive, then there was a counteroffensive and everything collapsed, and in November, everything was destroyed, including the empire. And then there was the Versailles Treaty, everything else. So there was a huge reaction, if you wish, which in part, well, there are many aspects, but one was anti-science, because the superiority of German science had promised victory, you know? And then there was this total defeat, and it was a shock, and people turned against, you know, science, rationality, progress, etc. And I think you see that in all the thinkers of that period, Heidegger, Spengler, Strauss, who became the father of neoconservatives, so even though he was Jewish and had to emigrate, I would even include in that Hannah Arendt, I would certainly include the Frankfurters in that. It was in general anti-science, anti-rationality, anti-progress mode. And my interpretation is that the same thing happened after the war in France because of the defeat. Of course, your country and my country were also invaded, but given the relationship of force with the German, wasn't such a humiliation, or it was unpleasant, but it wasn't so, you know, such a shock as it was for the French who had resisted in World War I and then had totally collapsed in a few weeks in World War II. And I think they never recovered from that. And you see constantly, if you listen to the discourse, you read the article, this constant reference to Nazism, anti-Semitism, collaboration, Vichy, etc. This has left an incredible mark on, you know, on the French people. So there was, that's my interpretation. And after the war, indeed, there isn't much rationalist thinking. Okay, I have some sympathy for Sartre, or at least for some of his political views, but is what is existentialism is difficult to discuss, but there's a lot of subjectivism and so on. And then after that, you have this pseudoscience under the form of structuralism or something like that. And then you have Lacanian psychoanalysis and so on and so forth. So the climate wasn't, you know, favorable for somebody like Chomsky, who is a rationalist, at least wants to be. Another example, which I think is even more striking, is Russell. You know, I never heard of Russell, by the way. And I, as I say, I read a lot, huh? But I've never heard about Russell before going to the States and even much later. And it's very funny that everybody in France who is cultivated knows how to spell Heidegger with two G's, but nobody, you would be amazed the number of people who don't spell Russell correctly with two L's or two S. I mean, people hardly know how to spell his name, so not to speak of having read him. And he exists in translation, lots of his exist in translation. And so does Chomsky, by the way. It's not that you don't know English, because in the other case, they don't know German. So, you know, I mean, why did they? I mean, it's very fascinating, because Russell was, you know, he was certainly a sort of socialist, but pacifist and rationalist and so on. And why did the French intelligentsia after the war, more or less the same generation as Heidegger, why did they all started to love Heidegger, who had been a card-carrying member of the Nazi party during for 12 years? And I think he even said, or somebody said that the German Metaphysics Center of Paris when the German tanks were leaving it. I mean, it's sort of surprising if it wasn't sort of a desire, an attraction towards some sort of, you know, let's call it irrationalism to be simplified, but you know, some sort of mysticism and something like that. Some depth, which is, you know, depth, but which is deep in unclarity. Well, Russell is whatever you think of his, and he's changed his mind many times, unlike Chomsky, but still he's somebody rather clear when he writes, okay? So it's one aspect. The other aspect, which I think has made, because that's maybe your next question, but about psychology, you must realize that at least since the 60s, what has dominated psychology, or what passes for psychology in France, is psychoanalysis. And mostly, I mean, not only Lacanian psychoanalysis, which to me is the most irrationalist version of psychoanalysis. But you see, France is with Argentina, the only country where psychoanalysis is still very lively. In France, you know, everybody, psychoanalysis, whatever it is, maybe there is less, there are fewer people having psychoanalysis now, I don't know, but the number of people, you know, who, you know, speak about it. I mean, the culture is full of that. People speak, make references to the unconscious and philosophy. They teach philosophy in high school the last year, which is in principle a good thing, but in practice, there's enormous amount of psychoanalysis, and the psychoanalysis is taken for granted. It's not even discussed. Mm-hmm. So that, of course, didn't make, you know, I'll go back to psychoanalysis later, but all this climate didn't make somebody, you know, and then there's this, you know, the social sciences, especially psychoanalysis, but not just that, are pre-Copernican. Chomsky is the Copernic of the social sciences, because Chomsky says, wait a minute, you want to do human sciences? Let's ask what humans are. What's human nature? What's the difference between human and dogs and chimpanzee or whatever? That's what makes humans human. So what is it, okay? And what is it for mental properties? Of course, people know about the lungs and so on, but what about the brain and the mind? And that is something which people couldn't be ready to hear, because everything was based in the end on your intuition of yourself. You know, people have an intuition of themselves. They have privileged access to their own sensation, their own feeling, their own thoughts, of course, but they have no access to the mechanism that produced them. So people say, oh, but my father was like that, and that's why I'm like this, and my mother influenced me, and the school, and so on. So on. None of this is true. I mean, nobody has any idea how, why they are what they are, why they think what they think, okay? But it's easy to tell a story about what it is, okay? And that's pop psychology, if you wish, and that's pre-scientific thinking. Mm-hmm. Now comes this guy who says, wait, let's forget about all this, and let's try to formulate abstract hypothesis about how the language acquisition work, and let's try to test them, and let's say that this is grounded in biology ultimately. It was inaudible.
Yeah, and kind of, you already mentioned this before, like, you know, taking Chomsky's thought, his focus on sort of biological properties, and kind of having a link with the political sort of arena. So you mentioned already, it's usually kind of seen when you go that nativist route as sort of a right-wing position. So how can we make sense of that? And also, you know, how does Chomsky respond to sort of those sort of arguments when people say that to him?
Yeah, well, you see, first of all, there is some sense in which it's understandable that people think it's right-wing, because why do men rape women? That's part of human nature. Why do government wage war? Well, that's part of human nature. Why do bosses dominate? So that's part of human nature, and so on. I mean, human nature, that's a slick answer from conservative to why things are the way they are, and they'll never change, and men are always going to be men, and women are always going to be women, and blah, blah, blah. And so, you know, you must have heard that, because that's the way the pop philosophy of conservatism, okay? Mm-hmm. But of course, it's not a scientific analysis of human nature, okay? And the jury is still out, at least with me, as to what human nature really is made of, okay? I'm not talking about linguistic, which I don't know much about, but in general, you see, it's not so simple. But of course, in one of your podcasts, I saw Chomsky quoting a guy named Buchanan, who is the economist from Chicago School who got the Nobel Prize, and he says that the dream of every individual is to be a master in a world of slaves. Mm-hmm. And that's a view of human nature. But of course, it's a pretty, I don't think it's a correct view, but it's certainly a view, and it's a pretty conservative view of human nature. So he's, you know, the free market, that's human nature, everything is described. So what does Chomsky reply to that? Well, Chomsky, of course, says that if you really object, I mean, first of all, he would say, you would also say the jury is out as far as what human nature really consists of. The other thing he would say is that if you deny it completely, then you adapt the thesis of infinite malleability. Mm-hmm. Okay, then if there is no human nature, then why can't you do anything you want with humans? In particular, why can't you make slaves accept slavery? Why don't you say colonized people accept colonialism? Why don't you make workers accept exploitation and so on, so women accept sexism and so on? Why can't you convince them by manipulating them? It's also an intellectual a view which is common among intellectuals, because it's a very elitist view that, that's common of all intellectuals in all countries, that, oh, but the masses are easy to manipulate, they're stupid and so on. Mm. And of course, Chomsky objects to that. No, he says, no, there is a basic human nature that leads people to revolt against oppression, and otherwise, how do you account for that? Because there are centuries of, you know, you can say that that's because socioeconomic condition change, that would be the Marxist answer, and that's not completely false. But of course, by itself, I don't see why, if there was no human nature, there wouldn't be revolt from slaves, you know, against slavery, for example, or women against sexism or whatever. So it seems to me that there is indeed, the human nature concept can also be used as a progressive notion, and also it opposes this idea, which is the ideal of many intellectuals, particularly of the technocratic intelligentsia, that, oh, but you can manipulate people. I mean, that was the whole idea of the, you know, what do you call that? The consent, I mean, the manufacture of consent. Okay? The idea of manufacture of consent came from somebody whose name I forget now, but he wrote this book on propaganda. And he said that, you know, in order for democracy to function, the elites must manufacture consent, the consent of the masses.
Yeah. So in some sense, like human nature, of course, you described like it can be, you know, used by many different people for different purposes, I guess. But in the end, it is kind of a scientific inquiry that should kind of clarify what it is, what human nature is. Although people might object, I guess, and say, OK, but human nature in and of itself is sort of a pre-theoretical notion, right, that has to be explored further. You know, is Chomsky's position that, you know, no, human nature is itself sort of a scientific concept, or more that it provides a direction of scientific research that might clarify certain part that would satisfy, you know, sort of a common sense understanding of human nature?
Yeah, that I don't know what the scientific inquiry would lead to or how far it can go. But for example, somebody whom Chomsky doesn't like and who certainly doesn't like Chomsky is Steven Pinker. But Steven Pinker is a big advocate of human nature, and he uses it to justify I would call American liberalism, not liberalism to court, but contemporary American liberalism. Is a big champion of American liberalism. And of course, this view, this in so-called enlightenment view, relies very much on the notion of human nature, which of course is fighting mostly against postmodernists and people who deny the notion of human nature. But also he has a part against Chomsky because he thinks Chomsky has too much an optimistic view of human nature. And he thinks that, you know, human nature is more, I don't want to go too much into Pinker, but I mean, you can see that the different, I mean, the sort of the view, which is now, I would say the dominant view, I mean, the dominant in the liberal intelligentsia in the United States, the one of Pinker. And that, of course, does rely on some sort of view of human nature.
No, I see. That's very interesting. And you know, Chomsky has also argued kind of, or at least critiqued sort of this French intellectual culture. You know, like you mentioned one specific quote where he kind of says that, you know, the French intellectual culture is kind of turned into a sort of Hollywood, right? So can you maybe speak to that? Like, in what sense is, you know, the French intellectual culture similar sort of phenomena like Hollywood?
Yeah, of course, I like this quote, but I usually don't like sentences of Chomsky of that type because, you know, Chomsky as an art, he's funny in some sense, but he has the art of being extraordinarily dismissive. So if you agree with him, it's okay. But if you don't agree with him, it's less pleasant because he can be very dismissive. We'll get to points where I don't agree with him, so later in the talk. So, but he's very dismissive, but he says it's something like Hollywood's a star system. And then it goes from one absurdity to another. What is striking, however, is the pomposity and self-importance at each stage. Of course, he was saying that, I guess, as a reaction to the new philosophers like Bernard-Henri Lévy, which is not so new. I mean, these people have been with me all my life, but they make an enormous amount of noise about this Soviet scene, which I don't think many people take seriously nowadays. But anyway, it's a Soviet scene as the discovery of the Gulag, which was known before, and then they made into a whole campaign against the Third World and against the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, for example. There was a whole bunch of intellectuals who signed a petition asking the US Congress to arm the Contras, for example, and many other absolutely abominable policies that they've been pursuing. And many of them were, in fact, in favor of even of the Iraq War. Of course, they were in favor of the Libyan War, of the Syrian War, etc. So, and of course, in the defense of Israel, to add to everything, this French intelligence, he did that, but of course, he thought that it was true more or less since the war, you see, that there was, and even when he was coming to France during the Vietnam War, before the Forestier Affair in the 60s, or seven, I guess in the 60s, he was going to Vincennes, but he wasn't very, which was a hotbed of, you know, leftism, but he was not very comfortable with it because he thought they were too dogmatic or too revolutionary in words or something like that. I don't remember exactly. I don't know exactly because I wasn't there, but he wasn't very enthusiastic about even the sort of radical left movement of that time, which we saw later, you know, many of them turn into neoconservative and neoliberals, etc. So it wasn't ready. So as I said, there was a lot of frivolity in the leftism of my youth.
One thing that I also remember, I think it was in this article as well, where you mentioned that in sort of French intellectual culture, at one point, it was also about choosing sides, right? Like, which side are you on? And that doesn't fit really. And I think that's actually interesting to highlight, that doesn't really fit Chomsky's approach, right? It's not about choosing sides. It's about kind of critiquing what's wrong, looking at yourself critically as a nation, etc. And it's not necessarily about, you know, one or the other.
That was very strong during the Cold War, of course. You were either on the Western on the Soviet side, but then it continued after that, you see. Now, with all the, you know, Islamophobia, you're either on the side of Islam or against Islam, and you have to take sides, and it's still like that, yeah. I mean, of course, this is sort of, you know, it's part of human mentality. It's nothing specifically French. There's something where people tend to take sides. They will support their soccer team or their nation and their religion and so on and so forth. So, but indeed, it was terrorized more openly. And then, of course, because of these things, you make amalgam. So you say, Chomsky is nativist, so he's he must be conservative. I defend free speech, but that's far right, etc., etc. You see?
Yeah. No, that's very interesting. And kind of moving to the famous debate between Chomsky and Foucault. So you also mentioned that this is, you know, one of the best introductions to understand kind of Chomsky's ethical stance, his moral thought. So can you maybe just explain from your view why this is such a great introduction? And then also maybe just provide the listeners a little bit more of a historical context for this debate.
Yeah, one thing is, of course, you can listen to the debate, I guess, on yes. YouTube. Something, but the debate, I think, is not very interesting. It sort of starts in a way where they, you know, they don't attack each other very openly, and they're sort of playing around and so on. Okay, so it doesn't start out being very very conflictual. It gets conflictual near the end, and there, of course, you see the difference between Foucault. Let me first explain how I see Foucault.
Yep.
Foucault, like many of these progressive 60s people, like Deleuze and Derrida to some extent, it's always referring to Nietzsche. Now, it's very strange because anybody who knows about Nietzsche, I mean, of course, I've read Lo Sordo, he's dead now, but he was an Italian Marxist who wrote a lot about Nietzsche. But of course, I've read Lukács also. I mean, I still, without being a dogmatic Marxist, I think my understanding of Nietzsche is that Nietzsche was a reaction against the rise of socialism by, you know, going all the way to undermine the notion of democracy and of equality. Okay, so then you have your superior people, and the superior people should run things, etc., etc., the superior races, and in the end, it's a way to attack, you know, the rise of socialism, in particular democracy. I mean, going to the root, namely attacking democracy and you know, the French Revolution and so on, but not doing it from a traditional conservative viewpoint, okay? Because you could be, no. I mean, it's from a sort of, although he would say he's against nihilism, but, you know, from what I would call a nihilistic viewpoint, namely you reject all values, you historicize everything. And Foucault, if you read Madness and Civilization or The Birth of Clinic and so on, so in all the book is, or on prison or on sexuality and so on, it's what I call discourse about discourse. Namely, he's going to study what people say. What people who, you know, constructed the hospital, the prison, and the asylum, etc., the mental hospital, and so on, said about the others, okay, about the prisoners, about the madmen, etc. But never at least maybe you contradict me because you know certainly better than I do, but never does he really discuss facts. You see, are there really criminals that are really dangerous to society? Are madmen people who really need to be helped and not left in nature? As at that time, there was the whole anti-psychiatry movement, so it was not just Foucault. And then I've known stories of people who were in mental asylum, and then to humanize it, you left them in nature, but then of course they ended up being beggars in New York or something like that. I mean, what one should do to help them, or what should we do with prisoners? And this is a very complicated question of which I'm not an expert, okay? But what I'm saying is that there are matters of facts. People are mentally ill in some sense. It's not just that society decides to repress them by calling them mentally ill. And of course, Foucault doesn't really say that, but Foucault only analyzes the institution that produced discourse. Even in an interview, which I quote sometime somewhere, he speaks of regimes of truth. Never speaks of truth. There are regimes of truth. Each society has its own regimes of truth. And they create, you know, instruments that validate truth, etc. He never speaks of truth as such. And that, of course, gets us into complete relativism as far as facts are concerned, as far as society, because the only thing that there are discourse. There are discourse. Here, so one guy says that one institution does that, etc. In a debate which I had with Chomsky in 2011 in Brussels, which you can even find on the web, it was in English, I was playing devil's advocate and defending Foucault. And Chomsky said that Foucault vastly overstates the role of social pressure and social influences on the construction of science. And of course, from that view, also from Kuhn's view, well, Chomsky seems to like Kuhn, but I don't. And of course, Feyerabend, and then the sociologists of science and all these people. Then from then started the idea that, oh, but science is just a social construction among others, and you know, and there's no particular preferred status, which something which of course Chomsky doesn't agree with. We'll get to Chomsky later about his view on science, but they certainly, he's been one of the first critics of postmodernism, and he has a remarkable article about what he calls X, namely where X is rational inquiry, and he speaks about what the postmodernists have said about X and so on. But Foucault was, of course, one of the root, he's one of the most famous thinkers of the 20th century. He's quoted all over the place, and he's one of the most quoted people. And he's been at the root of that because by focusing on institution, you see, it's not just because some institution produces a discourse that that discourse is wrong. The whole society produced a lot of discourse in England, but they were in the main right. And so did the French Academy of Science and the other academies in the 18th century. Lots of them were right. And it's not just because some institutions have repressive tactics and practices and everything they say is wrong. You will have to analyze the facts. And that never enters. So once you've decided that everything will be analysis of discourse and you have no connection to the real world, then of course, and even having a connection to the real world is considered positivist or something like that, then you're in complete relativism. And of course, once you're in complete relativism about facts, then it's very easy to go into complete relativism about more ethics, values, because values is more complicated than facts. And I think I will discuss that later, maybe about Chomsky, but I think ethics is ultimately what is good and bad in the end depend on factual judgment, mm-hmm. in my opinion. So at least in part. So of course, then of course, Chomsky said that he had never seen somebody so immoral as Foucault, and Foucault was actually totally rejecting that. So it's interesting because then Chomsky, and there of course, again, I listened to your podcast, you know, they are meant to make Chomsky understandable, but I'm afraid there are certain things I still don't quite understand with him. But anyway, about ethics, he says in the end, he's grounded in a certain notion of human nature. And then of course he says, if I had to be more precise, I would be in trouble because not so easy to make precise. Mm-hmm. And of course Chomsky, Foucault rejects human nature. He quotes in Mao because he was in Mao's face, so he says, there was a proletarian and a bourgeois human nature, which is silly, which is amazing. I mean, now, of course, you know, as I said, there is no human nature, but people reject human nature, so there is a different nature and worldview and the mind and so on for the gays and the lesbian and the straight and the white and the blacks and the Asian. I mean, whatever. I mean, people have been, humanity has been exploded into, you know, all these groups which have nothing in common, in particular no human nature, which I think is a terrible view. But at that time, it was the Marxist, the so-called Marxist view of human nature, namely there are only two human nature, two classes, and so on. So that was Foucault's view, but it was really not Marxist, it was Nietzschean. It was really the rejection of norms. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, Chomsky, of course, I think he's right that, and that's where I don't agree with him, and I'm not clear about what. Well, I think I understand what he wants to say, but I am basically utilitarian, okay, or consequentialist. I think things are good or bad depending on consequence and what the consequences are for human happiness or maybe freedom. Can discuss that, but consequences on humans, okay? And that, of course, depends on human natures. Earthworms, for example, eat soil, but you don't give soil to humans to be eaten because of human nature. There's a difference between the nature of earth and of worms and humans. Or take education. I mean, a century ago or two centuries ago, you know, education was extremely in our, we would say people, children were beaten, etc. I mean, in all classes, in school, in family, etc. And everywhere. And now we don't accept that, but that's because we have a certain view of human nature. We think it's bad for the children to be treated like that. Whether we are right or wrong is another question. I think we're in the main right, of course, but you know, whether we're right or wrong doesn't matter, because in the old days they had also a view on human nature. Implicit, what I'm saying is that all these things implicitly refer to your view of human nature. Mm-hmm. Or take people who train dogs, okay, not to defecate everywhere or something like that. Well, I don't know how they do, I have no interest in dogs, but the way they do it is because they think that the nature of dog is such that you have to do this and that in order to train them. So everything in the end, when you look at all moral action, the way you have jails and the punishment, everything in the end, or medicine and so on, in the end, it always implicitly refers to notion of human nature, but not explicitly. It's unfortunate. It would be better to be explicit, but ultimately it always refers to notion of human nature. For example, if you defend the free market, then you say it maximizes the satisfaction. I don't think it does, but the argument, you know, implicitly assumes something about human nature. So in that sense, I think I'm completely agreeing with Chomsky, but Chomsky doesn't like utilitarian arguments. That's where I don't quite agree with him. He has a view, if I understand him correctly, when I was with him in Brussels, he explained it to me in that way. He does what philosophers call the naturalistic fallacy. Of course, he doesn't think it's a fallacy. And I think you find that very clearly stated in Kropotkin. Kropotkin was critical of Kant, of utilitarian, etc. He was basically critical of all the discourse that try to say what is right and wrong and tell people, you know, you should do this, you should do that. He thought we should just look at properties of human and see what are those that foster moral behavior. You see, what are the circumstances that will foster moral behavior, but the moral behavior is in us. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what Chomsky has in mind. But he does say, even in your interview with you, I think he does say in the end, how do we justify that what we call moral instinct, you see, is actually good? And for that, I think you need, I would argue on a utilitarian basis, but he doesn't like that. But because he says, for example, if you take these trolleys experiments, you probably know about these experiments with the trolleys, then the spontaneous reaction, or many, many things also when you give money to people, you know, you know this experiment, you take a couple of people, you give 10 euro to one of them, and then he has to give something to the other. And then if the other accepts, then they keep the money. If the other refuses, then they lose everything, okay? And then when you do the experiment, people are willing to give 3 euro, 4 euro, 5, even sometimes 6 euro to be sure that the other person will accept, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, of course, when I do the experiment with my colleagues, it's always the same thing. We are the only people who are perfectly rational. Namely, we say, I'll give you 1 euro and the other will have to accept because it would be silly to refuse. But almost no human beings react like that. But I still think that just the way human nature doesn't fit, you know, a rational behavior doesn't mean that there isn't a rational behavior. And I think relying too much on human nature is dangerous also, because in human nature, in what is considered just by humans, there are also things which upon reflection are quite unjust. The people can be pretty violent, they can be revengeful. For example, the notion of justice also implies often a notion of revenge, of and these things are debatable. And I think you have to have a rational reflection about that, which again is based on utilitarian principles. So I wouldn't simply say you have to foster what is in our nature, unless you have a judgment on, an exterior judgment on what is in our nature that is good or bad. But I completely agree with him that everything depends on the notion of human nature, and rejecting it the way Foucault does then leads to complete relativism.
So maybe picking up on something you just mentioned, in some sense, and this also refers actually to an earlier episode I had with John McCall, who's at Georgetown University. He actually has a book specifically focusing also on the notion of moral competence. So in that sense, it would be interesting. We can talk about, sort of the descriptive effects that are there, but then you also get the additional question, like, is there some sort of normative justification built on top of that, which would maybe, for example, be justified to a form of utilitarianism or consequentialism. But it seems to me that Chomsky there says, no, we can look at indeed our human nature in this descriptive sense, scientifically sort of, inquire into, this specific sort of natural objects, or in the case of language, or in the case of morality, right? And then understand what this moral competence amounts to. But there it kind of stops, but it does seem to be going in a different direction than a lot of moral philosophy does, which talks about, deontology or, consequentialism or utilitarianism. This seems to take a more scientific route in the sense of, let's look at, children's notion maybe of justice, understand how they kind of have, this sort of moral competence built into them. So that does seem to be in line with more of what Chomsky does also in the, linguistic sense. How would you respond to that? Because it seems to, follow in a sort of exact same sort of path, and there are some additional questions, I guess.
That's what he told me also. He says that you do the same, he does the same thing as he does in epistemology. In epistemology, you don't put rules a priori. You just see how scientists do, what scientists do. Mm-hmm. I don't quite agree with him with his description of Newton and company, but that's another question. But if you take he says let's, epistemology is not done a priori, and that I sort of agree with him. Philosophers try to do it a priori, but I still think you have to have some notion of what is true and false in order to do epistemology, the same way you have to know some notion of right and wrong. I mean, if children have a notion of justice, but they have also a propensity to violence, what makes what you call justice right and violence wrong? I mean, unjustified violence, of course. I mean, if you have no other notion, it seems to me that, you see, there is a moral faculty, but there are other faculties, there are also faculties of reasoning. And I think we should use the faculty of reasoning to judge our moral instinct, some of which can be quite immoral, including, violence, revenge, etc. I think revenge, for example, is certainly deep in human nature. The reason in this test where you give the money to two people, why would anybody? You give to your neighbor, you give €1, okay, the minimum amount. And then the other person is going to reject. But if he rejects, then you both lose. If he accepts, he keeps €1. How on earth could anybody reject it if not to revenge the fact that you are so pingy? You see? You give him only €1. I mean, and because you expect the other to take revenge, then you give him more. Mm. Unless you are two mathematicians, and then, of course, you reason completely. You're completely rational, as I said, when I do it with my colleagues. But
That's interesting. But there, like you mentioned, like, for example, faculty of reason, right? So there, in sort of this architecture of different faculties, it seems to be that where you then kind of, ultimately say, okay, there is the primacy of, the faculty of reason that, in some sense, even overrides certain judgments regarding morality. And one interesting thing that I would also like to discuss with you, which is something related to the philosophy of mind, I guess, regarding the mind-body problem. And then specifically, of course, from your perspective as a physicist, how you kind of respond to sort of Chomsky's claims. So Chomsky famously claims that there is no mind-body problem because the problem cannot be coherently formulated because there is no notion of the body or the physical, because Newton destroyed it. And then he goes through a sort of a history of science lesson to make that claim. So maybe you can first maybe further elaborate, you know, what is Chomsky's claim, but then also, you know, if you disagree, what's alternative reading, I guess, of sort of the history of science, how Chomsky reads it?
I totally disagree with him. First of all, let me explain why I think there is a mind-body problem. Mm-hmm. I think that Nagel's argument in What Is It Like to Be a Bat is sound. But let me repeat the argument, okay? The bat has his echolocation. And now the question is, does the bat feel something? Like I feel pain, now I feel some pain, okay? Does it feel something when it uses echolocation? Well, we don't know. By some sort of principle of charity, we can assume that, but we don't know. And what I'm saying is that you can have any analysis you want of the body of the bat, of the brain of the bat, at any level you want, down to the last atom or last particle or any representational theory of what's going on in the brain of the bat, etc. You can have a perfect knowledge, a Laplacian demon's knowledge of the bat. You will have no idea, no feeling whatsoever, no impression of what it means to the bat. What does the bat feel? Mm-hmm. You may know what it will do. It will avoid an obstacle. You could predict everything of its behavior. No problem with that. Mm-hmm. But you don't know what it feels. And once you're, and that's if you wish, that's, you can formulate, not, there's nothing to do with Newtonian physics. You can say, okay, this has to do with the first person and third person perspective, or it has to do with the qualitative and the quantitative, etc. Everything we know about the bat is the quantitative, and we don't get the qualitative. Once you realize it's true about the bat, you realize that if, since we are men, we don't know what a woman has when she has childbirth, how she feels, and actually I don't know even how you feel if you have a toothache, okay? I mean, except by comparison with me. You behave, I say, oh, yeah, same thing, I had that, okay? Something like that. But you don't really know except by comparison with your own feelings. And the example of the echolocation is chosen only because it doesn't seem like we have anything like that, and then we cannot compare. That's the argument, okay? So it seems to me that Nagel's argument is sound. Actually, I did discuss, in the 90s, I was discussing by emails quite a lot with Chomsky, and he taught me a lot. I mean, he's, even from a physicist's point of view, is very interesting for my own philosophy of science, but there I don't agree with him. And he even mentioned to me, Russell said that, I mean, Russell, I think, invented, you know, the story of Mary who never, the brain scientist who never seen red, except he took the color blue. But, you know, somebody sees blues for the first time, never seen blue, what does it feel, okay? Yep. I prefer the example of the bat because I found that sort of settled the discussion more radically. But anyway, to me, there is a problem. There, the problem of consciousness. How do you account for consciousness on the basis of the physical? But the physical doesn't mean Newton's law. The argument is purely intuitive. It has to do, okay, give me all the information you want about the bat. There's nothing in Newton's law about the bat. It's most, you know, the brain cells and so on. This is all electricity, if you wish. It's not really gravitational forces there, okay? So it seems to me that there is mistaken. There is, I mean, also, which is funny, is that it does, I mean, that, you know, I know the book by Colin McGinn, which is defending mysterianism about certain problems. And one of them is consciousness. And he claims to be inspired by Chomsky. And Chomsky does say there are mysteries. But it seems to me that consciousness is a mystery and he doesn't seem to admit it. That's what I found odd. It seems to me that it's one mystery which we can say this is a mystery, and it's that, not free will, because free will, maybe it's an illusion. That's maybe not pleasant to think, but that's not something which bothers. I mean, I can't give an argument to show that free will exists as I can give an argument to show that consciousness is there and it's not accountable on the third perspective point of view. So now let me go to Newton and company. Okay. Newton eliminated the body. First of all, it's very strange Because when I teach Newtonian physics, I teach Newtonian mechanics, classical mechanics, etc., and theoretical mechanics, we always use the word mechanics. So to say that Newton got rid of the mechanical worldview, it's a very restrictive way to think of the worldview, okay? This is because it's pull and push forces and so on, and contact forces. But Newtonian is, first of all, the deterministic equation. There are bodies in motion, like the planets or the satellite or whatever. And this is purely, what could be more mechanical than that? It's just that what is true is that the gravitational force, it's not the only force, by the way, there are other forces in play. Gravitational force acts at a distance and instantaneously. Mm-hmm. And that is, of course, odd. And that's why Newton says hypothesis non-fingo, I don't force hypothesis, and it's an absurdity and so on. He says all these things. That's true. But to say that the world is not intelligible and the theory is intelligible, and Chomsky says that is something I don't find intelligible, because we have a certain understanding of the world. And to me, what is new with Newton, and of course his predecessor to some extent, he introduced a mathematical description of reality. Mm-hmm. Use mathematical concept like the force. Whether the force is instantaneous at a distance on that sort of an extra property. But the fact that we have this mathematical concept ever since then, yesterday I was listening to another philosophy seminar about realism. Ever since then, people have asked questions about realism. It seems to me that that's just besides the point. It seems to me that obviously science has to be realistic, and of course it achieves this goal, and our description of the world is basically realistic. But for this notion of electromagnetic fields, forces, curvature of space-time, the wave function, quantum mechanics, and so on, all these abstract mathematical concepts which we use in order to understand the world, when we go to describe objects which escape our common sense understanding. But if a biologist works on the cells or the brains, etc., doesn't need all these concepts. I mean, maybe use his statistics, or maybe use some differential equation for genetics or something like that, but there's no gravitational force at work in the brain. Plus, if you really look at the history of physics since Newton, people have tried to eliminate the action at a distance. Mm-hmm. Electromagnetism is by contact. It goes maybe at the speed of light, but it propagates from one point to another at a finite speed. And the general theory of relativity, also Einstein hated this idea of non-locality and non-local forces, and relativity, general relativity, sort of brings back a sort of gravitation which does not include this this instantaneous action at a distance. When we get gravitational waves from distant stars, as we observe them recently, they travel at a finite speed. So it does not, it's mysterious in the sense that it's mathematical, but it's not mysterious in the sense of Newton's action at a distance. So actually this sort of occult quality was taken care of by later physicists who got rid of it, except in quantum mechanics. But I suggest not to go in that. But that's something which I don't quite agree with the majority of physicists. So I think quantum mechanics has brought back action at a distance, and that was the root of Einstein's objection to Bohr and company, because he saw that quantum mechanics includes this action at a distance, and he didn't accept that. So that was his objection to the fact that quantum mechanics is complete. He said it's not complete because you need other variables in order to avoid having this action at a distance. But that's not neither here nor there with the discussion with Chomsky, because Chomsky doesn't use that argument. And in any case, it has nothing to do with the brain. I mean, the brain, as far as I know, is a big neural network. I mean, it's not. I'm not saying that the neural network and the theory of learning about networks is correct and so on. That's a separate question. But it's just a bunch of neurons connected by axons, and there's nothing. It's just chemistry, and I don't see why the destruction of the notion of body matters. Plus, the argument from Nagel about the bat is completely intuitive. It has nothing to do with having I understand it, you understand it without having any knowledge about how the brain works. No, I don't know how the brain works more than the next guy at the bus stop, as Chomsky would say. But so it seems to me that Chomsky is really able to defend paradoxical position. He's sometimes right, But, you know, like when he says that the U.S. won the Vietnam War, that I know what he means, what he means to say. He means they destroyed Vietnam, but it was a big defeat from their point of view in many ways, symbolically. And I mean, they couldn't accept that, etc. I mean, he sometimes sticks to, I mean, he's stubborn like a mule. So he sticks to, yeah, I know him. I've interacted with him personally, and I know many people who have worked with him and so on, and I can back up this statement. I mean, I like him in many ways, and I think if he wasn't stubborn, he would have, you know, yelled it under pressure, because not only, of course, his theory in linguistics were ignored, but then his political views, he's been attacked by, I mean, I've been attacked like crazy, but it's nothing, I mean, you know, they even canceled the physics seminar, but it's nothing compared with Chomsky. Chomsky had these hordes of Zionist students collecting every possible data against him and coming before his uncle, everything, and trying to prevent him from speaking wherever he was going to speak. So he has a thing, skin that thing in order to resist. So, you know, you have people have the quality of their defect, the defect of their quality. He wasn't stubborn, he would not be able to have resisted the way he resisted. So I like him, but you have to take him as he is. But I think this thing about Newton having destroyed notion of body seems to be, well, it's true at that time, and it's true still now, that we use mathematics, and the mathematics, we don't really see what they mean in reality. So once I propose that we combine three things. One is experiments. One is some pictures that we have of nature. We have pictures of atoms and so on, and then mathematics. But we should combine these three faculties together to get some understanding of what the microscopic world is like. Some people say, oh, let's do only experiments. These have no concept of atoms. They have no meaning except in experiment. That's instrumentalism. That I think is a mistake. Other people say, oh, let's forget about everything. These are just, you know, mathematical entities, and only mathematical entities exist. That's Platonism. That's also a mistake. And then, of course, there are also people who have little pictures of atoms and electrons, and that's sort of naive, okay? Let's put the three together to try to understand as best we can things which indeed we don't understand in a very intuitive way. But I wouldn't say that it has much to do, but when you come to the brain and the cells, you can have a picture of cells. You must have seen pictures of cells and axons on. So there is no such problem occur when you discuss electrons and atoms maybe, but not at the level of biology or chemistry even. Another thing where I don't agree with him, by the way, since we mentioned chemistry, is that he says that chemistry could not be reduced to physics before physics change with quantum mechanics. That's true, but nevertheless, now, you know, nobody in chemistry, well, except maybe by pure pride, would deny that chemistry is actually reducible to physics, the way biology is reduced to chemistry. So in the end, the explanation always goes towards the lower level. And when he speaks of unification, that's not completely true. It's not just unified. One is reduced to the other, of course, to the correct physics. That's true, but nevertheless, there's reduction. And he has strange views. I think he has an agenda there, which is that he doesn't like, biologists tell him, I've heard biologists saying that his linguistic doesn't fit naturally in a biological context, because he has all these rules, and biologists say, well, with the brain doesn't work like that. You can't have all these rules, etc. And maybe the rules is a model of a higher level description of the brain. I've no, as I said, this is not my field. I have no opinion. But I think he has always had a problem that, you know, biologists also tell him, well, you should study the biology, not linguistics, etc. And so he maybe thinks that his linguistic will be, you know, combined with biology, but with a change biology. But I don't know what change biology, what would has to change, you see. People have also a view, I think he has a somewhat Kuhnian view of theory change, which is far too easy. I saw that in the last video that I was watching, Einstein, I guess it's Norbert Einstein.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep.
He has a view about theory change, which I thought was far too Kuhnian. I mean, theories haven't changed that much. Newton mechanics is still used most of the time, every time you have a new theory, the first thing you have to check is that it has a limit in which you know, it fits the old theory, which is well confirmed. People make a lot of confusion between, let's say, Newtonian mechanics, which was superseded in some way, and the ether or the phlogiston, things like that. And they say, oh, but they used to believe in the ether and then they dropped it and they used to believe in the phlogiston. Yes, but it's not the same thing as Newtonian mechanics because, well, first of all, you could argue that the phlogiston actually was replaced by combustion and it didn't change all that much, but it wasn't well confirmed. You see, the way atoms is confirmed, the way Newtonian mechanics was confirmed when it was changed, etc. And it seems to me that people make much too much of a deal on, about theory change, like we are changing theories. I mean, quantum mechanics, you know, if quantum mechanics is superseded by some other theory someday, it will remain an extraordinary valid approximation, for example. And so is general relativity and everything else. So anyway, so that's my summary of my disagreement with Chairman Noam.
No, that's really helpful. And then maybe one last question is, do you think, you know, from a philosophy of science perspective, like one of the implications of Chomsky claiming that the notion of body has been destroyed is that we can talk, you know, we don't have an intelligible world anymore, we only have intelligible theories. So that we're kind of talking in that specific way. So maybe we still have some common sense reasoning going on, but you know, when we talk about science, we're only talking about sort of specifically sort of theory construction. Do you think that that distinction is helpful?
Well, you see, well, first of all, I could quote Feynman. I don't think he's always so deep, but he said sometimes that the question is whether Schrödinger equation contains, what does it say? Cat, music and morality or something like that. I mean, you could still ask reduction. I mean, I don't think that's correct because quantum mechanics is not just Schrödinger equation, there are all sorts of subtleties, but I think he's half right to say that. And then you could ask a reductionist question. I mean, the reductionist questions are still things which you could ask, you know? And there are models where reduction does actually work, like reduction of biology to chemistry, chemistry to physics, and so on. Not, of course, morality, but and also, I like Einstein's view of all people. Einstein said that scientific inquiry is nothing but an extension of common sense. Okay. Of course, it's more refined, etc. But Chomsky and the Chomskyans tend to, you know, separate the two.
Yeah, definitely.
How could Einstein say that? I mean, Einstein was introducing time, which is relative, and God knows what, and how could he say, well, it's the method, you see, the evidence, you're basing yourself on evidence, and the evidence that you have is the same as the plumber or the somebody who does a police inquiry or the car repairman or something like that, that, you know, they work, they inquire things and they have evidence for something. Scientists have evidence too. I mean, the Chomskyans tend to be very heavy on theory. And that's what I always worry a little bit, that it's too a prioristic, you see, and not so much on evidence. I've asked about evidence for their theories for many years. I found some evidence. I'm not saying there is no evidence, but it's not that overwhelming. And of course, there is a challenge from the point of view of people who say, well, you learn things and then, you know, you have to sort of see what is learned and what is not learned. I have no doubt that learning, of course, is as such, is an empty concept. If you say you learn from a tabula rasa, but what's in the original state, and how does it develop, and to what extent is there an input from the environment? That seems to be a complicated question to me. So I just don't know.
That's very
what the upshot will be. So I would be, as I say, I mean, to me, indeed, the conclusion of science are radically at variance with the conclusion of common sense.
Yes.
Mm. The method of science is not from common sense. That's what I'm saying. And in that sense, Chomsky sometimes, it seems to me that there is a streak towards idealism. Also, you know, his affiliation with Descartes and so on. I mean, I understand he's reacting against this behaviorist atmosphere in which he grew, but but there is some, I mean, also is rationalism. For example, I was listening to Einstein, I even listened to everything, but you know, in the end, we're all empiricists. Huh? We the ultimate tribunal is experience and observation. So there is a sense in which empiricism was actually fighting against the idea of innate ideas, not just disposition, but ideas, and against a priori proofs of the existence of God and against the existence of the soul and existence of this and that, you see. About maybe I could finish by mentioning about materialism. Somebody I like very much, which I don't think is very much read in English, is Diderot. Writing was the best in the Enlightenment thinkers. He has a dialogue with D'Alembert, who was the mathematician, and D'Alembert is asking him about, you know, the mind being there and not being located in a particular place, etc. And then he said, look at this statue and how do you make it conscious? And that's the argument for a materialist view of consciousness. He said, well, it's not very, it's complicated, but he takes the statue, he grinds it into little pieces, then he puts it in the soil, then he grows vegetable, and then he eats the vegetable, and then he said, well, the particle of the statue come in my mind, and then in the end, they produce sensation. And I think that's the correct argument. There is a continuity, obviously, between the inanimate matter and the conscious mind. But it doesn't mean that we understand the link. To me, there is an epistemological black hole if we don't understand the link between the two. But there is no doubt that there is a link between the two and that there is no special substance. When Chomsky says that by postulating a separate substance, Descartes was scientific, well. I mean, that's not so clear. It wasn't so scientific. What he means is that there is something special about the mind. That I agree. I agree that there are lots of people like Dennett and even Dawkinson who are naive materialists. That's true. And the church land and so on. And yeah, that's true. But you can be materialist like Diderot, saying that there's this unity of nature and yet admit that there is a mystery that we don't see, this thing which is produced by the brain, but we don't see how it's produced by the brain from our cognitive abilities. But it's strange that Chomsky both, you know, defends the idea of cognitive limitation, but then refuse to see it in the most obvious example, at least what I think the most obvious example. So there's something that doesn't fit, but you know, Chomsky is never going to move, so don't tell him.
No, that's great. So Professor Brinkman, this has been a really interesting conversation. I really appreciate your time. Do you have any last words?
No, I think you're doing a fantastic work.
Thank you.
By trying to make it Chomsky more understandable, but I still find that there are things that, well, there are two different levels, okay? One is technical linguistics, and especially everything having to do with meaning, you know, semantics, etc. I think I understand the work on grammar, okay? But the semantics, I never quite understood. And then, of course, there's a whole discussion about representation and the fact that this is very hard to understand, even for me, who has read a lot about Chomsky. And I find it, I understand, for example, when he says, you know, London doesn't refer to a specific place because you could destroy it and rebuild it 100 kilometers away and then it would still be London. Sort of, you know, these arguments are not completely obvious, as obvious to me as he says. I mean, and there is a way to refer to the world with our language. Otherwise, how would we know anything, you see? There is with his emphasis on internalism, he does have a tendency towards idealism. Because you quote Kant, you like Kant, but of course Kant is one of the source of idealism, which I don't like. I mean, it's that there is no more connection to the world. You see, innate knowledge, of course, about the world, and truth is correspondence to reality. So that's what I believe.
Oh, that's great. Yeah.
Maybe I'll finish with an anecdote. Once I was invited to give a talk about quantum mechanics to French philosophy professor in high school, in the last year of high school. And then, of course, after my talk, they immediately started to discuss Kant because they all are Kant, okay? Then I said, give me a synthetic a priori proposition which is true. And then somebody said, nothing comes out of nothing. Well, that's not a great discovery if that's true. Then they started to argue with each other because some people say, well, this is analytic, and the other, you know, this is a posteriori. So they couldn't agree. So I left the discussion.
No, that's very funny, but
we can have a discussion about Kant another.
Yeah, no, that's a whole other debate, I guess. But no, this has been great, and I fully agree. Chomsky is definitely a challenge sometimes to understand, but it's definitely a fun challenge.